Hi, welcome to this video where we are going to discuss how we build a scalable solution addressing complexities of ETL with ease using Apache Spark. Let me tell you something about us. We are a leading ride-hailing service provider in the Middle East, and we directly touch and affect lives of millions of people every day. We have our footprint across multiple locations and nations in the world. And in order to improve customer satisfaction, we have enhanced data-driven decision-making. Our in-house solution makes good use of Apache Spark to handle different complex situations related to the real world problems. I am one of the lead contributors to our in-house solution to address the needs and demands of the ETL. ETL, which is extract, transform, load, theoretically looks very simple. It is about collecting data from different sources, transforming it, massaging it, and then pushing the result to targets. Over the target, we have reports and visualizations which a user can happily access. But in practice, there are different complexities. Any process can get fail or it can get hung. For example, trying to read from a table which does not exist, maybe the resources are not enough, or some kind of unpredictable network errors. So whenever there is a failure and we try to restart it, there is a possibility that a process can get re-triggered multiple times. So there could be multiple instances of the same process running. When working over a cluster, we try to split the load across different queues. But when we have higher load, we use multiple clusters, and the different processes can be running on different clusters, and there has to be some kind of intercommunication or dependency between those processes. There are many different components, one for the ingest, one for the transform, one for the load. And different components can get modified. They will be added or removed with passage of time. As simple as that, a SQL file can get updated with a new definition or a new logic or a new data type. Also, with time, we have to support different mechanisms for alerting and monitoring. The other problem is related to the frequency. The sources are not extracted at the same frequency. There could be some batch processing where some sources are extracted, say, every 6 hours. Some are extracted on a daily basis. Some maybe on weekly basis. As well as there could be certain processes which run in a real-time streaming manner. We have to also make sure data is accessed securely, it moves securely from one stage to the other, and the quality of data is also maintained. So this is how our dependencies look like in production. You can see it's very messy and it's very hard to modify these kinds of dependencies. And I'm sure your ETL also looks like this, or eventually will look like this as the volume of data grows or as the demands of the business teams keep on coming. So if we list down the challenges of creating an ETL solution, these are some of the key points. We have to support a variety of use cases, and there should be early detection of any failure or delay. Ideally, there should not be any manual intervention in the ETL solution. It should self-recover. It should be extensible in supporting new sources, processing, or targets, or any combination of these. For the end users, it should be easy to access, especially the final data. There are always dependencies involved between different processes or different tasks. So adding a new dependency or removing a new dependency or removing an existing dependency or handling complex dependencies should not affect the other dependencies. We also wish to have intelligence in terms of resource consumption because that's limited. And a task or a process should get sufficient amount of resource. And yes, it should be scalable so that if the volume of data grows or processing needs increase, it should cope up with those requirements. What could be one possible situation? What could be the possible solution? One of the solution is to use a scheduler like Airflow, which has a DAX and have sub DAX inside it. The pros are, it handles the dependencies very comfortably, and it also supports features like task retries to reduce the failures which happen due to some temporary issues. With sub DAX, we also have the flexibility to contain the logically same entities together so that they process as a whole and afterwards the other sub DAG is triggered. But there are lots of cons in this approach. The first one, Airflow is not the best choice for running a streaming jobs continuously. Also, we need to build applications for each source combination and as well as target combination. Also, the processing logic which lies in between the source and target, we have to build an application for that as well. That application could be a Python script or it could be a Spark application, but we have to ensure there is application for the sources, targets, as well as the transformation. This all leads to high code redundancy when dealing with some of the common mechanisms like event sourcing, monitoring, alerting, or any other feature which is common to the different stages. Moreover, we need a different service altogether which can keep track of the freshness of the loaded data. By freshness, we mean how recent the data load was successful for a particular table. Considering all these things in mind, we have built our in-house solution which boosts the power of the ETL. It's called Shakti, which means power. So Shakti powers our ETLs. It handles complex dependencies of different types of user tasks at ease and at a scale. Minimalistically, you tell what to do, what are the sources, sinks, and what is the parent dependency, and it takes care of everything. It's powerful enough to handle and optimize the execution, supporting diverse types of tasks and supporting alerting, monitoring, event sourcing all together with respecting the dependencies. So how does it work? Let us take a very simple example of ETL. We have two sources, MongoDB and Kafka. Two different Hive tables are loaded from there. A third Hive table, T3, is populated by joining the tables T1 and T2. And then there is a final Hive table, T4, which reads from the Hive table, T3. What are the informations do we need for this ETL? The location and the name of the MongoDB table, the location and name of the Kafka topic, the names of the Hive tables involved, the queries needed to load from one Hive table to the other, as well as the dependency. For example, here T3 depends on T1 and T2, and T4 depends on T3. These are the information with which we can construct this ETL and write our application. The same pipeline, if we have to create with Shakti, we have to give the details in the JSON. Like what is the task type? What is the Hive table name? If it is a Hive task, if it is a MongoDB task, then again, it's like, what is the name of the MongoDB collection? Where is it hosted? Some tasks could be related to ingestion, while some could be related to transformation. Shakti will take care of everything. Not only this, some tasks could be batch, while some could be streaming. Shakti will run them all. The dependencies are optimized at runtime, depending upon the dependency, depending upon the freshness of the task as well as freshness of the parent. For the Hive tables, we swap the partitions. We will discuss this afterwards. A task which is already fresh, for example, if I say this task should run at least once a day, and if it has already run for that particular day, we need not to run it again. So that in that way, the fresh tasks do not execute, and that enhances the pipeline. We can also parallelize the tasks, like T1 and T2 can be run together independently. Shakti will ensure that no duplicate task is running at any point of time. The dependencies, for example, T3 depends on T1 and T2, could be mentioned in the same JSON, or it could be scattered across multiple JSONs. It doesn't matter for Shakti. Also, we can blacklist a task for certain duration we wish the task not to run. So if a task is blacklisted, Shakti will ensure it does not get executed. Also, the children of that particular task will also eventually get skipped. So for our application Shakti, we need to provide the input JSON, an optional configuration file, and SQL scripts if needed for that particular task. Shakti will create multiple Spark jobs depending upon different tasks. It will run them in parallel with a single Spark context running on the driver. The parallelism of the Spark jobs can also be controlled by the driver, by the submitter, by the person who submits. So what are tasks in our Shakti application? Tasks are simply traits. To create our own task, we just need to extend that trait and override its exec method. Inside the exec method, the definition of the task and the behavior of the task will go. Some of the existing tasks we use are Hive task for transformation, Parquet writer for streaming, MongoDB and Redshift task for ingress and egress, an external user task for specialized algorithms where we need to work on RDDs. Inside every task, an instance of a Spark session is available to be used. Let us see how the JSON looks like. A JSON contains multiple tasks. So it's a list of different tasks. For every task, we have the ID of the task and the dependencies, like on which parent does it depend. We can also specify what is the freshness criteria for the parent. In this example, for the current task, the parent task should have a freshness criteria of 1, which means the parent must have successfully completed at least once in the last 1 hour. If that is not the case, our current task is going to wait for the parent task to finish. Some tasks, say Hive task, require a SQL file, so we can specify the path of the SQL file. Also, the post SQL, which is used for the data quality, where we run a SQL which returns true or false, depending upon if the data was loaded, maintaining the integrity and the rules checks. We can also mention the SLA, which is in seconds. SLA indicates how long the task should take to complete. If the execution of the task overshoots the SLA, we get a notification. And finally, there is a freshness criteria for a task. Here, freshness criteria of one means the task should complete once in the last 1 hour. Or let me put it another way, if you try to retrigger the task one after the other, it's very probable that the next execution of the task will skip. Simply say, one task will not run twice in 1 hour. This is how the application conf looks like. It contains the configuration related to how many Spark jobs do we want to run in parallel, decided by number of threads. The Slack notification endpoint, where we would send our alerts and other notifications. It also contains the location of the Kafka brokers, the Zookeeper URL, and configurations related to the Spark session. All the configurations present inside the config Spark will be placed on the Spark session at runtime. Running Shakti application is a straightforward, is just like running any other Spark application. We have to build a jar, provide the application config, the JSON containing the tasks, and run it using Spark submit. Providing any packages if we need, any external jars if we need, configurations like driver memory, number of executors, and so on. If we want to run only few of the tasks present in the JSON file, we can also provide that as a specific tasks. The components of Shakti are the execution graph, which is the core part, which creates the in-memory DAG of all the tasks present in the JSON, the API, which gives a web interface to the user, as well as it is used inside the Shakti application to see the last status, the latest status of a task, and other details like if the task is blacklisted or not. We have a security layer, which essentially talks to the storage database, as well as it also connects to the Ranger for authorization, and it connects to the storage DB for authentication of the users. So whenever a user submits a task, that has to pass through the security, and then execution graph will create the in-memory DAG, and it will execute it respecting all the dependencies. Reporter is there to send us alerts and notifications. It could send the alerts to Slack or to Kafka or maybe both. And it is also quite convenient to extend that reporter to send those messages and notifications to a different place. Now the question is, why are we choosing Apache Spark internally? Apache Spark is the backbone of our Shakti application. The reasons are very obvious. Spark provides a very fast and performant in-memory processing. It has the support to cache frequent data. By frequent data, we mean data which is going to be accessed very vigorously and frequently for the dependent tasks. So in order to take advantage of caching, Spark is a very good technology to use. Also, Spark has a very powerful and elegant data unification strategy, where we can compose the streaming, SQL, and RDD operations together in the same application. Apache Spark supports many languages, though we are using Scala. The rapid development in Apache Spark is also a very crucial factor, where we get to have new benefits, new features, as well as very quick bug fixes whenever we hit any. This is how the web API looks like. We can provide the task IDs and it gives the latest status, like who ran it, when was it last triggered, what was the start time, or how much time did it take, when did it complete, and other details. In the bottom, you can see we can also check what are the tasks which have been blacklisted by different users. Whenever a task completes, we get a message either to its success or related to its failure, or if it was skipped, being blacklisted, or if its parent was skipped, we get all types of notifications. All the state is maintained inside MySQL DB. We have a very simple strategy to do that. We have two important tables, one for the ETL meta entries and one for the ETL speculation. ETL meta entries contains the state of a task. It is in an append only fashion where every execution of the task, success or failure, is maintained. And inside ETL speculation, we have an entry for every blacklisted and whitelisted task. A task is by default whitelisted if it has no entry in the ETL speculation. In the lifetime of a task, it enters different states, like starting, running, waiting for the parent to finish, success or failed or skipped. All those events are sourced to Kafka in the form of Avro. The JSON equivalent looks like this, like cluster name, app name, execution ID, task ID, status, message, timestamp. So if we want to go back in time and see how the task behaved on a specific occasion, we can check that. From Kafka, we periodically push that information to a persistent storage like S3, because in Kafka we can't store that for lifetime, or even if we try to do that, that's going to be very expensive. Since we are using heavily on cloud, machines keep on coming and going. We keep on spinning up our cluster, destroying them. So we have the logs coming to a central location. We are using Elasticsearch for that, and we visualize it using Kibana. Driver logs as well as the executor logs are stored in our central logging. To monitor the resource utilization, like how much memory was requested by particular Spark job and how much was actually used, something around it, or say CPU cores used, or number of tasks running, how much have failed, we use New Relic to monitor those. We can also make use of some other time series database like Prometheus or Grafana. All we need to do is provide the JMX exporter jar as driver extra options. Inside a single JSON, there could be multiple tasks. Say if there are 10 Hive tasks and those Hive tasks talk to different Hive tables for reading or writing. For every task, we authenticate the user as well as we check the permission of the user, whether the user has enough permission to read and write to a Hive table. It makes use of Apache Ranger service, where all our policies are stored. So Apache Spark talks to Hive server, and Hive server in turn helps to authorize it with Apache Ranger service. So we have our own custom plugin written in Shakti, which can translate the SQL logical plan and parse the information coming from Apache Ranger service to decide if the user has enough permissions. Let us talk about the optimizations we have made in our Shakti application. The most important optimization is the use of dynamic allocation, which is provided by Apache Spark, to spin up more or less executors depending upon the use as well as availability in the cluster. We tune the parameters based on the requirements of the Spark job, say driver memory, number of executors, what it has to be the memory of executor, how many tasks we want to run on each executor. All these are different for different Spark jobs. We make use of adaptive execution to handle any skewness in the data processing. Also, since we are writing to S3, we use a different version of file output committer. We are using the algorithm version S2, which is better suited for S3 storage. The one problem with S3 is when we are trying to write to a Hive table and say it is an insert overwrite, it's going to delete the previous file and push a new file. So the queries which are using the previous file, they will fail, complaining the file was not found. In order to prevent such a situation, whenever we are writing to a Hive table and if it is insert overwrite, we write to a new subdirectory in the S3. And on the success, we point the partition, the affected partition of the Hive table to the new location. In this way, any existing query will not complain about file not found. And the previous set of files, they are pruned periodically by a different service. We also consider data freshness and restructure DAG accordingly. Let us talk about that. Say we have a parent one, child one depends on parent one, child two also depends on parent one. And then there is child three depending on child two. This is the original DAG. What if child two is fresh? By fresh, I mean, suppose the freshness criteria of child 2 is 24 hours and it has already successfully completed in the last 24 hours. In such a situation, child 2 should not wait for parent 1 and child 3, which depends on child 2, will get triggered. Put it in a different way, this whole DAG will be split into two independent DAGs where child 1 depends on parent 1 and child 3 depends on child 2. The dependency between child 2 and parent 1 is no longer valid because child 2 will not execute and child 3, which depends on child 2, will execute sooner than the original plan. The other situation is, say if we have a child 1 depending on two parents, parent 1 and parent 2. By child and parent, we mean the tasks. They could be MongoDB tasks or Hive tasks, for example. And parent 2 is fresh for child. This could happen. Say, child 1 says, I want the freshness of parent 1 to be 1 hour, and I want freshness of parent 2 to be 1 week. And if the parent 2 has already successfully completed in the last 1 week, child 1 need not to depend on the latest execution of parent 2. Such an original proposal will again be split into two independent DAGs where child 1 will depend only on parent 1 and parent 2 can run independently without any dependencies. These kinds of optimizations help us handle different situations, combining the freshness of the task as well as freshness of the parent. So, how do you build Shakti application? It's simple. It's a Scala application. You can build it using SBT. But in a situation where we have clusters created and destroyed, say every hour or every day for sure, we want our clusters to be equipped with all the dependencies Shakti needs as well as the jar itself. So we have a Jenkins job which gives user an UI where they can select the network configurations, the spot price, the machine types of the cluster, the number of machines they need in the cluster, the Ranger and Solar configurations, the EMR version they need, and it's done. Once the cluster is provisioned, it contains all the dependencies and jars needed by Shakti application. Again, we take advantage of Airflow because Shakti is not a scheduler. Inside Airflow, we collect the logical entities together in a JSON, and that JSON is supplied to our Shakti application. This makes our Airflow dependencies look much less messy. Running, say, 400 tasks, combining them in groups, we have, say, 20 or 25 Airflow tasks. Inside every Airflow task, we have, again, multiple tasks running in different threads managed by the Shakti application. Let me talk about how we have used Shakti application. We run more than 150 heavy jobs every hour, and this powers all of the organization's data team, from data science, warehouse, business intelligence. It serves all the verticals of the organization. We process more than 2 terabytes of data every hour. With the help of Kafka, as well as Shakti application, we have near real-time data lake in production, which has brought data closer to different data teams. With all our optimizations, we have doubled our use cases, reducing the cost by more than $250,000 in 1 year. Shakti also is very compliant, and on the end result produced by our application, we run more than 20,000 queries per day in the presentation layer. As we move ahead, we are planning to add some more features to our Shakti application. One of them is the query cost computation. As of now, all the Spark jobs, the tuning parameters we give it, the tuning parameters we give to them are done manually. With feedback and machine learning in place, we plan to decide the resources which has to be allocated to a Spark application or a Spark job at runtime. We also plan to analyze Delta Lake and EMRFS so that for the currently generated hot data, we don't need to talk to S3. This can further improve the runtime of our pipeline. Or the other alternative can be to store the recent hot data, say for the current day or current hour, depending upon the freshness or the frequency of any task, in HDFS, and have another job to migrate data from HDFS to S3 and altering the partition of the Hive table underlying it. The other task which we are focusing on is to have a self-service data platform for the enhanced user experience, which is going to be web-based, where just by click of some buttons or and some drag and drop, user can create their own pipeline. And yes, we also wish to open source the project. So that was all about the Shakti application, how it has helped us achieve better insights with data and the optimizations we have made and how it is powering our data teams. I would love to know your feedback and your questions if you have any or if you're concerned. Thank you.